Good morning, girls. This is Shelby. I'm just giving y'all a little bit of a view of what I'm seeing this morning as I'm coming to you live this morning for our 40-day challenge, day 7. And I'm going to invite a few people while we wait. If you're watching this on playback, you know the routine probably by now. It takes just a second for everybody to get the notification from Facebook that we're live. And then I will hop right in there and get started with our morning. Good morning. I see some people joining. Good morning. Hope everybody is enjoying a Sunday morning, beautiful Sunday morning. This is my view, y'all. This is my front yard from my porch. This is typically where I like to gather to have my devotion time, my coffee time before I go into some prayer right out here. So, good morning. Hey, Ricky, how are ya? All right, so I'm gonna turn this around and we're gonna get started. Good morning. My video is a little bit foggy. Excuse me while I, there we go, that's a little better. Good morning. Hey, Mary, how are you? Good morning, good morning, good morning. We're going to get started on day 7 in just 1 second. I'm giving a couple of people the opportunity to get the notification that we're live, and then we're going to get started, girls, on this early Sunday morning. I hope you all have had a great weekend so far and that your day today will be awesome as well. If you're gathering together with a body of believers, I pray that you have an awesome experience with God in worship, corporate worship. Hey, Betty, good morning. All right, so we're going to hop right into day 7, girls. Hello. So here's what today's topic is about. Your heart thoughts are louder than you realize. And the scripture basis for today is going to come from Matthew chapter 9, verse 4, and it says this: "Know their thoughts," Jesus said. Why do you entertain evil thoughts in your hearts? And this is what Karen Eamon, who is the author of this 40-day challenge devotional that we're doing, this is what she says. She says, "From the bottom of my heart, I want you to know that God is teaching me some things in this 40-day challenge." And isn't that so true? Listen, you can't teach anything from the Word of God without it getting off on you. I mean, the Word declares that that the word will not return void. Like, every time God's word is sent forth, it's going to accomplish something in your heart. Whether you're the teacher, whether you're the listener, whether you're just someone who is participating in it, the word of God is effective. So this scripture passage for today comes from Matthew chapter 9. And in it, there are several stories of interactions that Jesus had with several different people in the word of God. And so one of those people is the tax collector. And Jesus goes in with the tax collector, and he begins to sit with the tax collector and has dinner with the tax collector. And there were people in the room that had an issue with the fact that Jesus was having this this dinner with someone that they saw was so unfitting and so unworthy, you know, of his presence, you know, someone that was that was supposed to be righteous and was supposed to be religious in their mind. So while he's at dinner with the tax collector, it says the Pharisees went to his disciples and said, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" And then she says, notice that the Pharisees didn't direct their questions toward Jesus. They asked his disciples. And yet upon hearing this, Jesus said, it's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick, right? So Jesus, they weren't even talking to Jesus. They were talking to his disciples, and he overheard the conversation in his heart. Like, we don't know, the Bible doesn't say that he was close enough to hear them, but I'm sure that if they weren't bold enough to go to Jesus and ask him this question, and they went to the disciples, it's probably because they didn't want him to hear them, right? Have you ever had somebody that, you know, had an issue with you or saw something in your life they didn't agree with, but instead of coming to you, they went to other sources, and they just, and they don't want you to know that it was them, that they are the one who said something. You know, people do things anonymously now to come against you, you know, or send in, you know, some kind of, I know it unique. People can report us to corporate, and a lot of times they'll do it anonymously because they don't want anybody to know that they're the one that did it, you know? And so, they do it indirectly. But here's the thing that is pointed out in this passage in Matthew, is that Jesus knows, even when we talk to other people, he knows, he hears the conversations that we have with others, right? The ones that we think nobody else hears, the ones that we think that nobody else sees, the ones that we think that is just us, you know, but Jesus knows them. And so today, Karen is warning us to think about the conversations that we're having with others. And when we think that, you know, especially today, all across the United States on Sunday, typically in a lot of churches, there will be people who will be gathering together for corporate worship. And some of them will come together and they'll raise their hands maybe, or they'll stand at the singing of a song or at the reading of the scripture, right? And they look around and they think nobody knows what they've done or what they've said or where they've been or the things that they've thought. But here's the thing, the one that you're raising your hand to, the one that you're praising, he knows. He knows what we say to each other. And I won't ever forget that there was a time when, years and years ago, I was having a little heated fellowship with my husband about something. I don't even remember now what it was about. It was something insignificant, I'm sure. And I was upset with him, and we'd not been married for very long. I was young, you know, and we were having some heated fellowship, and he went off to work. And typically what happens for me now even is after he goes to work and after the kids go to school, that's when I have my quiet time or my prayer time, you know. And I just remember I turn on some praise and worship music, and I was praising in my house, and I was just saying, oh, I love you, Jesus. I praise you, Jesus. I'm so thankful for you, Jesus. You know, those kind of worshipful things. And in my spirit, after I would say it, I would hear this echo in my mind. And it would be like, I love you, Jesus. And I thought, what is that? And then I would hear, I praise you, Jesus. And I mean, it was just like, I heard the words that I was saying, but I heard it with attitude and just anger in my voice, and it just kept on. And finally I just stopped, and I was like, God, what in the world? What is this? And God, Holy Spirit reminded me of the scripture that says, as much as you do unto the least of these, your brethren, you do it unto me. And God taught me something that day, y'all. He said, you know, my children are made in my image. And when we say things to other people, when we do things to other people, it's just as if we're doing them to God himself. He said, if you do it to the least of these, you do it unto me. You know, even the ones who we may say in our mind are the least of these, the ones that we feel like are insignificant, or the ones that we feel like deserve it the most, right? Even those. And so what God told me that day is, he said, you know, you can't just talk to your husband any old way and then come before me and think you're going to worship me and I'm going to just accept that worship from a pure heart, when I know your heart is not pure. And in the way that you spoke to your husband, you spoke to me. It was as if you were doing it to me. So now whenever you start to worship me, I receive it through the filter of your heart, that you, that same heart, that same mouth, that same mind, those same emotions that you used to speak to your husband is how I receive it when you speak to me. Oh my goodness, y'all. You talk about heartbreaking. It was an eye-opener for me. And so in this lesson, this is in today's challenge, this is what Karen wants us to see, is that even what we say to others, that God sees it. He sees our heart and he hears the tones. And as much as we speak to the least of these, our brethren, that's the way we speak to our God. That's the way it feels to him whenever he hears it. The other story that's in this passage is the story of some friends, four friends that have a friend who's a paralytic, a man who is sick and can't walk, and they carry him 40 miles on a stretcher, and they get to Jesus, and they can't get into the house where he's ministering because it's so packed out. So they climb up to the roof, and they tear a hole in the roof because they're so desperate to get their friend to Jesus. And they put the man down through the roof, and Jesus, he heals the man, and he says to him, your sins are forgiven you. Take up your bed and walk. And there again are some religious people that are standing around, and they said in their heart, the Bible says they pondered in their heart, and they said in their heart, you know, he's blaspheming. And Jesus, the Bible says, hearing it, they said it in their heart, y'all. They didn't even say it out loud. They said it in their heart. And the Bible says Jesus heard it, and he turned to them, and he said, you know, let me find the scripture where he says it. Hold on, let me give it to you so I can make sure I'm giving it to you right. It says, and he turned to them and he said, why do you entertain evil thoughts in your hearts? Jesus can actually hear our thoughts. This is what Karen says. Not only can he hear our thoughts, but he can respond to our thoughts as well. If Jesus can hear us think, I hate this, I quit, I'm not sure I like her very much, with what words do you think that Jesus would respond to the things in your heart today? When we drill down deeper into Matthew 9, verse 4, we discover the Greek word for knowing has several definitions, one of which is to see with the eyes. So when Jesus knows our thoughts, he actually sees our hearts. He actually can look into our hearts and he sees our thoughts. I sometimes think of my heart and mind as a closet. Inside are fresh emotions, percolating questions, and even evil thoughts, right? All of us have those that enter from time to time. She says, the evil thoughts are probably hanging in the back somewhere, like an old pink taffeta bridesmaid's dress I can't fit into, or some hideous fad clothing from the 80s. One thing's for sure, Jesus sees it all, and he knows what will not be fitting to my waist or to my lips, right? Yes, Jesus sees our hearts, y'all. He sees our hearts. He sees how we talk to others. And here's the last point that she makes. She says, finally, let's look at the woman who touched Jesus' cloak to find healing in chapter 9. All this is in chapter 9 of Matthew. The Bible tells us a woman who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years came up behind him and touched the edge of his cloak. She said to herself, if only I could touch his cloak, I will be healed. And Jesus turned and saw her and said to her, take heart, daughter. He said, your faith has healed you. And the woman was healed at that moment. Jesus even hears the words that we speak to ourselves, y'all. Again, we don't know if this woman spoke loudly or softly. We don't know if she spoke it in her mind or just in her heart. We just know that she said these things to herself. What a beautiful response Jesus has. He turns and he looks at her. Listen, she captures his attention with what she says to herself. I'm so sorry, y'all. My internet is wonky out here. So she captures Jesus' attention with what she says to herself. And so he turns and he looks at her, it says. And Karen asked this question. She said, if Jesus were to turn and to look at you right now, what would he find you saying to yourself, right? What are you saying to yourself? And what is it that's going to capture his attention today that you're speaking to yourself? One of the things that I've said to ladies so many times, because I find it so true, sometimes we'll say things to other people that we'll say things to ourselves that we would never say to other people. I can't believe you said that. You're so stupid. You're so crazy. You never make sense. You know, you're a fool. I can't believe you fell for that. I can't believe you were... Right? You're so ugly. Look at your thighs. Look how awful you look. You never look as nice as so-and-so. She's so much prettier than you. Of course your husband doesn't love you. Of course he's not attracted to you, right? We say those things. Of course she doesn't want to be your friend. Look at you. Look at it, right? We say those things to ourselves. And the Bible says that this woman pondered some things to herself. She said them to herself, and it captured the attention of Jesus, and he turned and he looked to her. So here are today's takeaways, y'all. Says, keep a clean wardrobe. Instead of wardrobe, like a closet, she says wardrobe. Jesus hears those unspoken words of your heart. We've talked about previously how thoughts become the birthplace for your words. Today, we likened our heart and mind to a closet. What kind of wardrobe do you have hanging around in there? Keep it clean, keep it fresh, keep it full of promises and things that'll bring life to the relationships. Even if someone in your life right now is not doing things that are beneficial to the relationship, be careful about the words that you allow to hang out in your heart, in your wardrobe today, right? Because if your heart is that you want reconciliation to be there, then the only way that you're going to be able to have reconciliation with that person and be able to forgive them and walk in grace toward them is going to be to make sure that you keep those words in your heart and in your mind and the things that you think about, keep them life building, right? Keep them in a line of words that will lead you toward restoration and reconciliation with that person. If you go over and over what they've said, if you go over and over what they what their heart's intent are. You have to sometimes, y'all, just cast those down and choose to believe the best in others, right? We say that, you know, that we're supposed to operate in the love of God. Do you know that in 1 Corinthians 13, one of the things that it says that love does is that love always hopes for the best in others, always believes the best in others. So love is a choice. Love is not a feeling. Love is not goosebumps or butterflies in your belly. Love is a choice. Love is hard. Love is work. Love is being intentional, right? So if you're going to believe the best, always believe the best in others, there are some people you're going to have to work at that, right? You're going to have to work at loving them, because some people make it almost impossible to love them, right? They do things over and over and over that make it hard for you to believe the best in them. So you have to work at it. So keep your wardrobe clean, your wardrobe clean, right? And then consider Jesus' response. You might not be asking Jesus a question or expecting him to respond when you have a conversation with a friend, but he can step in at any moment, especially if you give him permission to at the beginning of your day, like we're doing now. Consider what he would say to you if he heard your thoughts. Would he see those words and find them to be fitting of the wonderful child of the King of Kings that you are? Would he find that in your heart? Thank you, Betty. Thank you. All right, here we go. Here's the lessons for the lips. Ask God to make you aware of the conversations you have with yourself. I could probably make it a long time without evaluating this, without evaluating how I'm talking to myself. But what about you? What kinds of conversations do you have with yourself? Write down the unspoken words that you tend to repeat to yourself. I love that she's concentrating on this today first. Then look up one of God's promises that will reorient your unspoken conversation towards something that Jesus would find to be sweet, to give you life, right? To point you in the right direction. It might look something like this. Oh, I am so not looking forward to today. And then you redirect your thoughts with a scripture. Psalms 118, 24. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, right? So find a scripture whenever you're feeling like, there's no way I can do this today. There is no way that I'm going to be able to accomplish what I need to accomplish. Then you go and find the scripture that says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, right? Whenever you find the thought that, you know, nobody loves me, nobody cares about me, nobody, you know, nobody has plans to do, nobody wants to do anything with me, you go to Jeremiah 29:11, where it says that I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord. I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord. Plans of good. He has already making plans for you. He's making plans that include him. He wants to do things with you. He wants to walk this path with you, right? Oh, I'm never going to make it out of this situation. This situation, I'm going to die here. It's never going to change. You know, it'll be this way for as long as I live. And then you go to Isaiah 43:2, where he says, you're going to pass through the waters, but they're not going to overtake you, for I, the Lord, am with you. You're not in this thing by yourself. And then it says you're going to pass through the fire. It's not even going to kindle upon you. That's my life verse, y'all. Yeah, you're going to go through some things, but you're not going to die here. You're not going to stay here. You're not going to live this way forever if you choose not to, because God has made a way out, right? The Bible says there's no temptation that has befallen any of us except that the Lord makes a way of escape. There's always a way out of any situation if we will choose to direct our thoughts right, choose to direct our words right, and let God guide us. He will lead us out of these things, right? Not ourselves. We're not going to fix it ourselves. Listen, if situations in my life could have been fixed by Shelby, it would have been fixed a long time ago, because trust me, I try to fix everything that happens, and the Lord has to tap me on the shoulder and say, no, baby, no, no. If you could fix it, you would, but you can't. So you're going to have to depend on me in this situation, right? Oh my goodness, so many times that has happened. So what's in your wardrobe? What are you pondering in your heart? What are you allowing to stay in your mind? What are you speaking to others today? Be aware that even those little secret conversations that we think nobody else hears but us, those secret text messages and private messages on Facebook, right? Those things that we whisper to one another that may be labeled as gossip, that we try to disguise as a prayer request. I'm just telling you this because I need you to pray, sister. You know, why is it that our flesh just craves drama, right? Why is it that our flesh wants to be the first one to run with bad news to tell somebody something? You know, it's so crazy to me. You know, you hear of some tragedy that happens in the community and people rush. They may not even know the people, but they rush to put it on Facebook. They want to be the first one to put it out there. It's just so, our flesh. Oh my goodness, if we could just get out of this flesh and just walk in the Spirit, as the Bible says. All right, girls. Yes, Kawana, girl, he knows the way out. He knows the way out, right? I try my best. It's like, you know, whenever you are in an unfamiliar place and you're spending the night maybe somewhere in someone else's house that you're not familiar with, and you get up in the middle of the night and it's dark and you're trying to figure your way out and you can't find a way out, or you're like those little mice that are in those mazes that you see that these scientists put in there, and they're trying to figure their way out, and bless their hearts, they find a dead end. That's me. Anybody else, raise your hand with me. Is that you? Sometimes that's how I am, y'all. I'm just trying to find that way out, and I'm trying to do it myself and feeling my way around. And if I just stop and say, Father, I don't know how to get out of this. I don't know how to change this situation. I don't know how to fix this. I don't even know the next step to take, right? God, I can't take another step. I can't say another word. I can't make another decision except you guide me. I surrender your plans for me. Oh, God, help me find my way out of this mess that I've created, right? And that's so hard sometimes, y'all, because, you know, I know that I find for myself that I can trust God to lead me out of situations that I didn't create for myself a whole lot better than when it's a mess that I've made, that I've created, right? Then that guilt and condemnation comes in, and I feel like I don't deserve God to get me out of this because I did it to myself, right? Oh my goodness. And sometimes if we're not careful, those thoughts can even bleed over into others. We look at other people and they're in a situation and they ask us to pray for them, and we have a hard time believing with them because we say, hey, you created that mess. You get your own self out, you know, or you deserve it because of what you did. The choices you made got you here, baby. You deserve to stay right there. I ain't praying for you. Okay, am I the only one that has those thoughts? Maybe so. I'm the only one confessing here. Where's everybody at? Okay. All right. Let's pray, girls. All right. And I'm going to let you go and get ready for your corporate worship. I hope you're gathering with believers somewhere today, because I'm going to tell you, it makes a difference. When you come together with like-minded people, there's something about corporate worship. I love worshiping on my own. Y'all, I do. I love the secret place with me and Jesus, me and Holy Spirit. But I love corporate worship with a body of believers as well. So I hope you'll find somewhere to go. We need it in these last days, y'all. We need to gather with some people who will encourage us and inspire us. So, all right, let's pray. Father, I thank you so much today for this word that Karen has given to us in this 40-day challenge devotional. We pray for her right now, wherever she is, well, whoever she's gathering with today, God, that you will bless her with your Spirit, Lord, as she worships, that you will come down and visit with her today and bless her for what she has done and given us this tool that we can use to examine our words. Father, I pray for all of my sisters today and brothers that are watching this on live or on playback, God, that you will make us aware of our wardrobe today, that, Lord, we'll be aware that the thoughts in our heart, the things that we ponder, Lord, even the secret things that we've not spoken to anybody, that you hear us today, God. You know the desires of our heart. And, God, we want to focus, Lord, not just on the negative things that you see, but, God, you see the secret desires, the wishes, the longings, that, God, we don't even have the words to be able to formulate those things, but you see those and you know those, God, and we just thank you today that you're willing, God, to bring those things to pass in our life. We thank you, Lord, that you hear the conversations that we have with others. And God, help us to be mindful. Holy Spirit, we give you permission to help us to be mindful today that even the conversations that we think nobody else hears, that you are present with us, God. And that, Lord, you've told us that the things that we do, even to the least of these, that it's as if we are doing it unto you. Help us to be aware of that so that when we speak to others, we speak in tones that we would speak in with you if you were standing there, God, instead of them. And God, we thank you. you, Lord, that you hear the things that we speak to ourselves. Help us to be mindful, God, of the words that we speak to ourselves in our heart, God. Help us to speak words that will help us to accomplish the purposes and the plans that you have for each of us. Help us, Lord, to speak things to ourselves, God, that would be worthy of speaking to a child of the King, because that's who we are. Lord, help us not to speak anything to ourselves that we wouldn't speak to princesses or princes or kings or queens or priests, God, because that's who you have declared that we are, that we are ministers of yours, that we are a royal priesthood, God, that we are set apart, Lord, for your purposes and your plans. And help us to speak those things to ourselves, God, that would lead us toward your purpose, lead us to believe in ourselves, so that we can step out and partner with your plans for our lives. We thank you for what you are speaking to each one of us through this 40-day challenge, God, and we commit our hearts to not just be hearers of this word, but to be doers of it as James instructed us, God. In the name of Jesus and for your glory alone we pray, amen. Amen, girls. Yes, yeah, see you soon, Sharon. I can't wait to gather with you this morning. Hi, Diane. I hope you all have a great day. I love you bunches, and I will see you back here tomorrow morning at 7 o'clock for day 8. Have a great day. Hey, don't forget to share this video if you got someone that you know would enjoy being a part of this or could use some of this, find value in it. Please share this video, and let's get more people on board with us, okay? All right, have a great day, y'all. Love ya.